Hello and welcome everyone to your week 2 lecture. So this week's lecture is on diabetes. And as I have guided you previously, please do look at your pre-readings first. So your pre-readings are in form of lecture slides itself. So these are the couple of pre-readings. So these are the learning objectives that we are going to be covering this week. And the following slides are the pre-readings. So these ones are for you to browse through. It's very simple. That's why I'm not going over it. I'll go over more complicated concepts which are there for this lecture. And bear in mind, this lecture is a bit long. So be prepared. All right. So yes, now these slides that are going to be covered, they are going to be covered by me. So we'll start. All right, so what is the difference between insulin sensitivity and insulin resistance? So what is insulin sensitivity? It is in terms of quantity, very important to remember. Meaning how much insulin is required by the body to regulate some amount of blood sugar levels. All right, so it is how much insulin, meaning the quantity of insulin which is required. Insulin sensitivity is higher with regular exercise, healthy diets, not excessive amount of visceral fat, which is surrounding your vital organs. All right. Whereas insulin resistance, the concept of insulin resistance is that how receptive are these cells, meaning specifically what on the cells, insulin receptors. How receptive are the insulin receptors to attach to the insulin? All right. So how strong is the insulin receptor insulin complex? Okay. So basically, when you have high visceral fat, which is surrounding your organs, meaning you have excess amount of fat layer over the cells, this will decrease the insulin receptor insulin complex. Okay. This complex is weaker when there is a lot of fat in between. Okay. Excessive amount of visceral fat. The insulin receptor insulin complex is also weaker when you have high amount of inflammation, and we'll be going in detail as to how inflammation can result in high insulin resistance. Okay, so basically very important to remember that insulin sensitivity and resistance are inversely proportional to each other. Meaning if you have high insulin sensitivity, which is a good thing, you will have low insulin resistance, which is also a good thing. Okay. If it's the opposite, low insulin sensitivity, high insulin resistance, that's a bad thing. All right. That's why both concepts are inversely related. Now, this slide is basically just to show you in simplistic form that apple shape obesity or central obesity, which has high amount of visceral fat around your organs, this will result in high insulin resistance, logically. Okay. Similarly, when you have pear-shaped obesity, so you have a lot of fat on butts and thighs, but that is not where the organs are located, meaning you have lower insulin resistance, which again is good. Okay. So low insulin resistance, good thing. High insulin sensitivity, good thing. And important to understand the difference between the both. Okay, so now the very important concept, which is the role of inflammation. Okay, so there is a new term in research, which is called as diabesity. So what is diabesity? It is diabetes plus obesity. Okay, so previously, very early on in very, very old eras, okay, not exactly in the Stone Age, but you get the picture. All right, so anti-inflammatory medicines like aspirin, they were used in the treatment of type 2 diabetes. Obviously, but aspirin is not the ideal treatment for type 2 diabetes. You keep taking it regularly, it will have its own side effects. So this was stopped. But basically, the main finding over here is that anti-inflammatory medicines were used in type 2 diabetes, and this resulted in regulation of blood sugar levels. So something anti-inflammatory is the main clue over here. So yes, research then started focusing on what is the role of inflammation in these two major chronic health disease conditions which has infested the world, which is diabetes and obesity. So we are going to understand the role of inflammation. All right. So yes, one more previously what was thought, which was wrong, was that fat are dormant cells, meaning the only function of fat cell is to store fat in the body It does not do anything else. But now we know that is absolutely wrong, because fat cells, they have the ability to produce their own hormones like adipocytokines. And we studied about adipocytokines in your week one lecture, in the obesity lecture. So if you don't remember, go back to that. All right. And yes, when you have these adipocytokines, they can act as inflammatory agents. Okay, so basically, what I'm trying to say is we need to understand the role of inflammation in causing insulin resistance. Okay. So before you understand the role of inflammation in diabetes and obesity, it is very important to understand the basics of your immune system. Okay. So you have, you have lymphocytes. Okay, so what are lymphocytes? They are immunomodulatory agents. All right, so what do I mean by modulatory agents? They have the ability to produce certain type of cells. Okay, what are these type of cells that the lymphocytes can produce? You have T cells and you have B cells. T cells, they produce certain types of cytokines. Interleukin and tumor necrosis factor. Interleukin 1 and 6 is the most important one, which we are going to be focusing on as part of nutrition and disease curriculum. All right. And tumor necrosis factor. These two are of our interest. There are different types of cytokines which are produced in the body, different functions. Majority of the research in the area of diabetes and obesity are focusing on these two cytokines, tumor necrosis factor, interleukin. Therefore, we'll be focusing on those. And then you have B cells. Your B cells produce antibodies. Okay. Then you have the other thing which you have in your immune system is your monocytes. Okay. Basically, I call them as eaters, is because monocytes, basically they eat pathogens, they eat harmful bacteria. Basically, their way of protecting the body is by eating the bad guys. Okay. So that's your monocytes. And when they eat something, they are called as macrophages. Okay. Then you have neutrophils. Neutrophils is your first line of defense. So when you have any bacteria, virus, pathogen entering your body, neutrophils are the first one to get activated. They will tell the lymphocyte something is happening, some foreign element is there. So start activating the immune system. And that is when lymphocytes will release the T cells, B cells, depending upon what is required in the body. All right. Then you have the basophils or eosinophils. They are parasite fighting. Okay. So they will be fighting the parasite. The key ones, which are most important for your unit nutrition and disease, which we are going to be focusing on, is your lymphocytes, your monocytes. Okay. These are the two main important things in the context of nutrition and disease. All right. So moving forward. So yes, there are basically, the biggest theory over here is that when you have high inflammation rate in the body, okay, so you have high inflammatory agents in the body, this results in high insulin resistance, and insulin resistance can cause obesity. How does it do all that is what we are going to be studying. Basically, guys, your unit nutrition and disease is lots about understanding the pathophysiological mechanisms. And there are various hypothesized pathophysiological mechanism for you to just bear in mind. The ones which I am teaching you as part of this unit, which you're covering, are the pathophysiological mechanisms which have been extensively studied, extensively researched. Those most common pathways or mechanisms is what I'm teaching you. There are various other which are postulated hypothesized mechanism, but because they are still in the hypothesis stage, they are not being taught to you. So to keep it simple, the mechanisms which you will be learning and nutrition and disease, this unit is all about understanding the pathophysiological mechanisms. So the mechanisms which you will be learning, they are the ones which are most extensively researched. If you come across something else in the literature, it is not wrong. It's just that this was most extensively researched and therefore it's being taught to you, all right, as part of the curriculum. But of course, if you had to do research in this space, we would be looking at all sorts of mechanisms. All right. So I hope this is clear. So basically over here, the conclusion is that, as I said, some sort of inflammation in the body, chronic inflammation, can result in insulin resistance and obesity. Okay, so guys, this is just an FYI. As I said that, if you go ahead over here, you have your lymphocytes. Okay, so lymphocytes produce T cells, which I said. Okay, so yes, your lymphocytes, remember that slide, lymphocytes produce T cells, and the two most common sort of inflammatory substances which are produced by T cells are the one which we are going to be focusing on as part of your curriculum, which is interleukin, okay, 1 and 6, and tumor necrosis factor. All right, so there are many, many other inflammatory substances. The most common one which you will see in repeated lectures is interleukin and tumor necrosis factor. So yes, your T cells do produce inflammatory substance, and these are two of the many more which are there. Okay. So now, basically, this slide is to tell you that these are the various types of conditions in the body which are inflammatory conditions. All right. And these are chronic inflammatory conditions. When I say chronic, it means long term. Okay. For example, diabetes, if an individual has diabetes, we know there is no cure for diabetes. You can only manage diabetes. Diabetes is a chronic inflammatory condition. Okay. Meaning it's a long term condition. All right. Similarly, chronic hepatitis, chronic pancreatitis, chronic kidney disease, CKD, rheumatoid arthritis, gastritis. If you see any of these TIS, when you have TIS added to it, TIS means inflammation in medical terminology. That is what it refers to. Okay. So these are all chronic inflammatory conditions. And if you see, obesity is also a chronic inflammatory condition. Okay. Very important. So basically, why is obesity a chronic inflammatory condition? Because obesity is still a new phenomena in terms of human evolution. All right. So we were not born to be fat. Okay. Or when we were born, we were not fat. Okay. So human beings being obese is still a new phenomena from an evolutionary point of view. Your body is still not adapted to the concept of being fat. And now I'm using very colloquial terms, just so that it becomes easier for you to grasp the concept. Okay. So yes, we were not meant to be fat. All right. But now in the last 50 years, we have seen that obesity is an epidemic condition. Okay. Like we have seen epigenetics in the last lecture, and how 90% of the population is at the risk of obesity because of underlying genetic conditions. All right. So this is what I'm saying, that obesity is considered as a chronic inflammatory condition, okay, by the body. If the body is obese, you have a sublime level of inflammation going on. Okay, now there are two mechanisms which will answer the question, which is here. That is, how does obesity cause inflammation-induced insulin resistance? Meaning, how does obesity cause diabetes in simple terms, okay? So first, we are going to look at how obesity is causing diabetes, and there are two mechanisms to it. When I say, guys, there are two mechanisms to it, it is very important to understand that it is not that one mechanism is going on in the body, that finishes, then the second mechanism is going on. No, this is actually interlinked. This is going on simultaneously. Just to teach you, I have separated this into two mechanisms. In your body, it is not number one going on and number two going on. This is going on as a whole unit. Okay, so hope that makes sense. So now, going to the main mechanisms. So the first mechanism of how obesity causes type 2 diabetes. All right. So yes, when you have an individual who is obese, as I said, obesity is an underlying condition of chronic inflammation. Okay, so you have sublime inflammation going on. Now you have to connect these dots to your lecture one. As I said, in nutrition and disease, you have all of these lectures which are interconnected. Okay, so when you write your responses, you have to think of this kind of explanation which I'm saying. You see, a lot less is written on my slide, and a lot is which I say, because it's all over here. It's difficult to write all of those points on the slides. It's practically impossible. The slide will become too wordy, okay, and it will be difficult to understand. That's why when you write your responses in your exams, for instance, you have to connect these dots. Obesity, this is a condition of chronic inflammation. All right. When I say it's a condition of chronic inflammation, if you look at your lecture one and you had the slide on epigenetics, your epigenetics slide indicated and clearly stated that when you have obesity, which is a condition of sublime inflammation, you have impaired gene expression, meaning you have, say, mutated or you have malformation of your DNA, RNA nucleus, okay? Your main, say, your main genetic bodies, okay? So you have impaired gene expression, all right? Now, when you have impaired gene expression, the macrophages, which are produced by an obese individual in comparison to an individual of healthy weight, all right? Those macrophages are also impaired. Firstly, if you see over here, high number of macrophages present in the fat cells, okay? So yes, there are more number of macrophages which are present in the fat cells of an obese individual. And furthermore, these macrophages are genetically impaired, okay? Why are they genetically impaired? Because obesity is a condition of sublime inflammation. When you have chronic inflammation going on in your body, this will impair gene expression, all right? And impaired gene expression, meaning impaired immune system. When you have an impaired immune system, you have impaired macrophages which are produced. Does this all make sense? All these connections, okay? Then what happens? I'll go very slowly through these mechanisms because your entire lecture is filled with mechanisms. So now we know in an obese individual, okay, so this is speaking from a generic point of view, okay, it's not that every obese individual, but from a generic point of view, what the theory postulates is that in an obese individual, yes, you have increased number of macrophages and they are genetically impaired. All right, so that's these two points which I said. Increased number of macrophages, yes, they are genetically impaired. Then what happens? These genetically impaired macrophages, which are higher in number, they will release inflammatory products such as cytokines, okay? So yes, you have these macrophages which will release cytokines, or even there is another thing. Again, as I said, it's not written in the slide. These are the things you have to make connections of. When you have greater number of macrophages in the body, your lymphocyte system gets activated, okay? Your lymphocyte system says, why are there so many macrophages in the body, in the fat cells? There surely must be something which is going wrong. Let me directly release those T cells, and those T cells will then release inflammatory substances, okay? So yes, you have macrophages which are genetically impaired. Because they are genetically impaired, they release inflammatory products such as cytokines, and then directly your immune system is also activated, which is your lymphocytes, all right? And your lymphocytes then will start producing greater number of T cells, which is a direct source of producing inflammatory substances such as cytokines, okay? So basically what is happening, you have lots of cytokines, and these cytokines, as you know, are inflammatory substances, and the key types of cytokines which are produced are your interleukin 1 and 6 and your tumor necrosis factor. Okay, so yes, now when you have lots of inflammation in the body, which is inflammatory substances such as tumor necrosis factor, cytokines, this leads to insulin resistance. Now, what do I mean by insulin resistance? Now, you know, it is the poor complex between the insulin receptor and insulin. Okay, so the complex is not being formed because of inflammation, all right? And obviously, you know that in an obese individual, there is greater amount of visceral fat. Visceral fat will also mechanically prevent the complex being formed between the insulin receptor and the insulin, okay? And similarly, because of inflammation, you again have this weak complex between the insulin receptor and insulin, and therefore you have high insulin resistance. And thus, when you have high insulin resistance, you have poor transportation of glucose from the blood into the cell. Therefore, you have high blood sugar levels, which is an indicator of type 2 diabetes. Does that make sense, guys? So in summary, in an obese individual, you have impaired genetic expression. When you have impaired genetic expression, it leads to macrophages, which are greater in number. And these macrophages have the ability of producing its own inflammatory substances, cytokines. This will also, on the other hand, activate your lymphocytes, activate T cells producing cytokines. Therefore, overall, what is the net results? You have increased inflammatory substances, cytokines, which are your tumor necrosis factor, interleukin 1 and 6. And all of this then leads to insulin resistance, and insulin resistance meaning causing type 2 diabetes. Okay? So this is your mechanism 1. All right? So now moving on to your mechanism 2. Now you, if you see over here, guys, this blue thing is there on both of these slides. Mechanism 1 and you have this blue box. You have mechanism 2 and you have this blue box. Just to show you that how these two mechanisms at this stage where you have the blue color, they unite and they do the same thing, which is increase insulin resistance and therefore type 2 diabetes. Okay, so that is where both of these mechanisms, they amalgamate together. Okay, right now they are bifurcated into these two streams. Okay, so now the second mechanism says that in an obese individual, again, this follows from your obesity lecture, you have hypertrophy. And if you remember what hypertrophy is, it is increase in fat mass. Okay, so the size of the fat cell. So yes, you have big fat cells, large size fat cells. When the surface area or the size of the fat cell increases, the need of that cell also increases, meaning the oxygen requirement, nutrient requirement of those big fat cells also increase. But on the other hand, what is happening? You have less oxygen, less nutrients, which are being transported or provided to these big fat cells. All right. And remember, in an obese individual, it is highly likely that they already have hypoplasia and now they are having hypertrophy. Okay. So then what happens? Why do you have less amount of oxygen nutrient being transported to that fat cells? Because of less oxygen RBC saturation. You know, your RBC is the main thing. Okay. Your hemoglobin is the main thing, which is carrying that oxygen to all parts of your body. Right. So you have less oxygen saturation of the RBC. Okay, and why is this so? This is because, why do you have less oxygen saturation? Because you have a low resting metabolic rate. Why may you have a low resting metabolic rate? Again, you have to go back to your obesity lecture. You have to go back to your autonomous nervous system. And in your autonomous nervous system, I spoke about sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system. All right. So when your autonomous nervous system functioning is impaired, it could be secondary to a metabolic condition such as hypothyroidism, or it could be because obesity is a sublime condition which has overall impaired your resting metabolic rate and your metabolism. And therefore, you have less oxygen saturation capacity of the RBC, of the hemoglobin. Okay. So now, what happens to an individual whose oxygen supply is cut off? They die. All right. The same thing happens to the cell. Okay. When you have less oxygen, less nutrients which are reaching the cell, the hypertrophic cell, the cells start dying. Okay. The death of cell is called as necrosis. Okay. In medical terms. So yes, you have necrosis of the cell happening. When you have a lot of dead bodies, okay, which is necrosis of the cell, then what happens? This will trigger your immune system, because anything which is dead in your body, dead cells, etc., that needs to be cleared off. Okay. So when you have necrosis of the cell happening, your immune system is the one who can clear it off. So yes, your immune system is triggered. When your immune system is triggered, meaning your monocytes are triggered, your monocytes within the fat cells. So now these monocytes, they start eating all of these dead cells. They become into macrophages. Okay. Now you remember the first function, these macrophages, remember, they are more in number, and these macrophages are genetically impaired, meaning they will release a lot more of inflammatory products such as the cytokines. Okay. And as I told you, on the other hand, when your immune system is activated, your leukocytes, they automatically will produce a lot of T cells because of obesity as it is. Okay. And T cells meaning cytokines, cytokines meaning interleukin 1, 6, tumor necrosis factor. Okay, yes, so you have a lot of inflammation meaning high insulin resistance, less insulin sensitivity, which therefore results in type 2 diabetes. Okay, so yes, over here, the second mechanism talks about morphology of the fat cells. Okay, meaning you have hypertrophy and you have less oxygen nutrient reaching that. And because of which? Necrosis. Because of necrosis, you have triggering of the immune system, macrophages and T cells, therefore resulting in inflammation. inflammation resulting in insulin resistance and therefore type 2 diabetes. Okay. So these are the most two commonly researched mechanisms in the literature, which we have covered. There are many, many more, but yes, I won't go over all of those. Otherwise, you will faint. Okay, so let's just keep to the two most commonly researched mechanisms. Okay, so basically, guys, this is how obesity can result in type 2 diabetes. And this is how, when generically you must have heard people saying that you should have a watch over your weight because then you are at risk of type 2 diabetes. You now know exactly how this happens. Okay. So now the question has changed. What's the question? How can insulin resistance cause obesity? Okay. Meaning when you have a diabetic individual, all right, type 2 diabetes, this can result in obesity. Okay. So insulin resistance can again trigger inflammation, and this inflammation can further result in obesity. Okay, so diabetic individual at risk of obesity is what we are talking about. Now, this mechanism is a bit more longer. I could not fit it in the Word document. In the PowerPoint, and therefore I'm sharing it as a Word document. So let me just share it with you. So I'll share the Word document now. Share Word document. Yes, I hope you can see this. So rest assured, all of this is available on your Canvas. Okay. So now we'll go over this. You have high insulin resistance. Okay. You have high insulin resistance. So this is because the individual is diabetic. Okay. So now the question is opposite. You have a diabetic individual. In a diabetic individual, obviously you have high insulin resistance. Okay. When you have high insulin resistance, what does this mean? It means the glucose levels in your blood are high, okay? High blood sugar level, all right? Hyperglycemia, okay? So yes, you have high insulin resistance. Because of high insulin resistance, you have hyperglycemia, high blood sugar level. So now what happens? Obviously, when you have lots of glucose in your blood, some amount of glucose will definitely be used for energy production inside the cell. So in a diabetic individual, as you know, naturally a type 2 diabetic individual has the capacity of secreting some amount of insulin. The amount of insulin is not sufficient to a level of a healthy individual, but there is some amount of insulin secretion. So yes, in a diabetic individual, you have some amount of insulin secretion. This some amount of insulin secretion will help the diabetic individual to take some glucose from the blood, take it into the cell. When the glucose is in the cell, that is when you have energy production, which is your glycolysis cycle first, and then your TCA cycle, okay? This will generate your normal glucose being taken up for energy. However, as I said, the insulin is not sufficient in a diabetic individual. So you have large amount of glucose, which are still floating in the blood, because of insulin resistance. Okay. So yes, you have large amount of glucose in the blood because of insulin resistance. Now, when you have these free molecules of glucose, which are floating in the blood, this is what happens. Okay. So you have free molecules of glucose in the blood. Okay. Now these free molecules of glucose, they will combine with the oxygen, which is there in your blood. And this will result in free radical damage and oxidative damage, okay, which is called as oxidative stress, all right? So this is what happens. You have these free glucose molecules in the blood, excessive amount of it, okay? This is not a healthy amount. This much amount should not be there in your blood. But when you have large amounts of these glucose molecules just randomly floating in your blood, they will react with oxygen in your blood. And this will result in free radical damage, which is called as oxidative stress, okay? That is one thing. The second thing, what will happen, this excessive amount of glucose, which is there in your blood, this will start combining with amino acid molecules and fatty acid molecules. Okay. Now, glucose combining with protein or fat molecules, this is called as advanced glycation end products, AGES. Some of these students ask me, is it okay to just write AGES in your exams? No. Okay. You need to write the exact terminology. All right. So as I said, this unit is heavily intertwined with biochemistry. You need to remember these terminologies because if you are planning to practice as health professionals, and this is a health unit subject, it is not an art subject, all right, or not a commerce subject, then yes, there are certain terminologies that you will need to remember. So yes, advanced glycation end products. Okay, then what happens? Then when you have these free radical species which are floating in your blood, okay, they will cause genetic, this will cause altered gene expression, okay? Because free radical damage, guys, oxidative stress has the ability to increase inflammation in its own capacity. So when you have free radical molecules in your blood, this in itself will trigger the immune system and it will increase inflammation. Free radical damage, okay, or you have free radical ions in your body, they in itself are inflammatory agents, okay? So they will trigger the immune system, but they themselves are inflammatory agents. And because they themselves are inflammatory agents, they then can alter your gene expression, meaning your WBC RBCs, okay? The basics of your WBC RBC, DNA, RNA, nucleus. So all of those main the main fundamentals of your body, this will be genetically altered, okay? So remember, free radical damage, it has the capacity to not only trigger your immune system, which can release inflammatory products, but they are inflammatory agents in itself, okay? Then, so guys, these, remember when you have lots and lots amount of glucose in the blood, high blood sugar level, and if the diabetic individual is, say, exposed to any sort of cuts and wounds, which say on their fingertips, on their toes, this excessive amount of glucose in the blood, when it is exposed to the natural environment, okay, which has a lot of bacteria and other sort of pathogens and things, this can lead to sepsis, and sepsis can lead to gangrene, which is you have further gangrene is say lot of sepsis, okay? And if this is not amputated or treated in time, this can lead to systemic sepsis, meaning all those sepsis, they are going into your blood in very simple layman terms. And this can result in death as well. Okay. So sepsis is when you have bacterial inflammation pus, you know, in simple terms, when you have an acne and if you poke that acne, then it develops into that yellow dirty mucusy thing. That is pus. That is basically bacterial inflammation, and that happened because the bacteria in the environment, they entered into the skin and they started growing, the bacterial body started growing. Okay, so similarly, when you have a lot of glucose in the blood and the wound is exposed to the environment, the bacteria, they love this lots of glucose in the blood. That's food to them. So they start eating all that glucose, they start growing, multiplying, causing sepsis, pus, and excessive amount of that is called as gangrene, which then needs to be amputated. Okay? So this is what I said, gangrene, if wound is infected. All right? So if they do have cuts and wounds. That's why regulation of blood sugar level is so important, because high blood sugar level, high risk of bacterial contamination, infection, high risk of gangrene, and gangrene, if not treated well, can lead to amputation. Okay, amputation basically cutting off of that finger and things, because you don't want that sepsis to be traveling in your blood and then infecting the whole body. Okay, so yes, guys, at the end, what is the basic conclusion of this? You have free radical ions, they are inflammatory agents in itself. Advanced glycation end products are also inflammatory agents in itself, all right? And when you have lots of advanced glycation end products in your blood, when you have a lot of free radical ions which are floating in your blood, this automatically will trigger your immune system. So at the end, you have systemic inflammation in your body, okay? So meaning you have a lot of inflammatory molecules which are there in your body, in your blood. When you say systemic, it means blood. And blood goes everywhere in your body, and that's why it is systemic. It is not local. It is not specific. It is systemic. Okay? So yes, now when you have a lot of inflammatory blood which is flowing everywhere in your body, this inflammatory blood will go to all of your various organs. Okay? So now let's see how the organelle system is being affected. Okay, so you have systemic blood, which is entering your gastrointestinal tract, okay, your GI tract, When it enters your GI tract, when inflammatory blood with inflammatory compounds such as advanced glycation end products, oxidative free radical damage ions, and you have automatically cytokines, all right? And the cytokines meaning your interleukin 1, 2, tumor necrosis factor. When all of these sort of molecules, they enter into your GI system, they trigger the production of lipopolysaccharides, LPS. Now these lipopolysaccharides, again, they are inflammatory products in itself, okay? So you see how one inflammatory product is triggering the production of another inflammatory product. So yes, lipopolysaccharide is an inflammatory product in itself, and this again will result into inflammation, okay? So now when you have this inflammatory molecule, systemic inflammation happening in your brain, hypothalamus, then what happens? Then you have leptin resistance. You remember in obesity, I said one of the reasons for leptin resistance is increased systemic inflammation. And now you see how, okay? So yes, you have high systemic inflammation. This will result in leptin resistance, okay? And when you have leptin resistance, it means your body cannot see that there is a lot of leptin in the blood, meaning I should tell the individuals to stop eating. No, you may keep on eating, and this will result in high caloric intake. And if this is compounded with low energy expenditure, this will increase the risk of obesity. Okay, so you saw that how you when you have systemic inflammation, this results in leptin resistance, and leptin resistance, as you know, can trigger obesity. Okay, then when you have the systemic inflammation in your liver, what does this do? Liver is your main site for glucose metabolism. Okay, like your TCA, glycolysis, gluconeogenesis, all of that. The main site for glucose metabolism, carbohydrate metabolism, is your liver. All right, when you have systemic inflammation, this will impair the functioning of glucose metabolism, all right? The efficiency with which you have glucose metabolized in your body, meaning glucose used for energy, glucose stored as glycogen, gluconeogenesis happening, meaning fat and protein taken for the production of glucose, all of these cycles, they will be impaired at the baseline level, at a fundamental level, okay? And why? Because you have inflammatory compounds which are entering the liver. So the liver functioning is compromised. Remember, whenever you have inflammatory blood, meaning systemic inflammation in any of your organs, the basic functioning of that organ will start being compromised. All right. So yes, when you have glucose metabolism, which is impaired, what does this happen? This will trigger insulin resistance because you don't have efficient conversion of glucose into glycogen or glucose into energy, things like that. All right. So this will trigger insulin resistance. Okay. Impaired glucose metabolism is equal to high insulin resistance. Okay. Similarly, when you have impaired leptin, leptin resistance, you have obesity. Okay. High risk of obesity. So now at the end, again, over here, inflammation will result in insulin resistance. You have obesity. Now, obesity is a sublime condition of chronic inflammation. And you know how obesity can result in inflammation in itself and how obesity can cause insulin resistance. These three boxes, obesity, inflammation, insulin resistance, and this is your type 1 and type 2, the mechanism 1 and 2, which we covered in the PowerPoint slide. Okay. So, all of this. This and this is your mechanism 1 and 2 in the PowerPoint slide. Okay, so obesity causing type 2 diabetes is what we have covered. Now you know when you have sublime inflammation, this results in insulin resistance, glucose metabolism impaired, automatically you have insulin resistance. And when you have insulin resistance in total, this causes type 2 diabetes. Okay, so this is how you have insulin resistance, which results in obesity, and obesity in turn can cause type 2 diabetes, and insulin resistance can further is a risk factor for type 2 diabetes. Okay, so you see it's a vicious circle, and which is what I have summarized over here. I'll just share the screen with you again. All right, so just bear with me. So now over here, in summary, this is a vicious circle. In the mechanism 1 and 2, we saw how obesity causes inflammation, and inflammation results in insulin resistance, which is type 2 diabetes. In the Word document, we saw how insulin resistance, type 2 diabetes, causes systemic inflammation, and systemic inflammation can result in obesity. Okay, so this is your vicious circle. All right. So now, in terms of the main nutrients and diabetes, with respect to carbohydrate, generally your diet has 45% of energy coming as carbohydrate daily to prevent ketoacidosis. And what is ketoacidosis? All of that. We'll look into this in much, much detail in the coming slides. In medical nutrition therapy to dietitians, I will not be covering that because this unit is not meant for you to become dietitians. This unit is for you to understand the pathophysiology behind diet and disease. Okay. So yes, when you are managing or supporting a patient with diabetes, the dietetic skills of carbohydrate counting are very important. The concepts of glycemic load versus glycemic index is very important. Now, this you may have partly covered in food science, but again, these are the concepts of a dietetic student, medical nutritional therapy. Therefore, they are not covered in detail over here. Fructose, as you know, is absorbed via passive diffusion. It does not need insulin for its absorption. Therefore, yes, fructose is not going to increase your blood sugar levels, for example. Okay, but as you know, fructose is not satiating as glucose. All right, and why? We have covered the mechanisms in lecture 1, all right? And fructose, you cannot consume excessively concentrated form of fructose because this then can result in various other issues such as you have your non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, you have your uric acid and gout problem, so a lot of endogenous fat production. Therefore, fructose is called a sweet poison, and hence fructose needs to be consumed in moderation, all right? So this all is covered well in detail in week 1. So fructose is okay for a diabetic individual, but not in excessive concentrated amounts, okay? All right, so now fiber. Yes, fiber definitely has shown good results, positive results with diabetes, because when you have fiber, okay, a moderate fiber diet, for example, it has shown to improve glycemic control. Why? Because when you have high fibrous food, you have slow release of glucose into the blood. And in a diabetic individual, type 2 diabetic individual, where you have natural secretion of insulin, which is impaired. So you have slow and small concentrated amounts and small amount of insulin secretion. When you have slow release of glucose into your blood, then the natural insulin in a diabetic individual, which is in less amount, they can still manage this glucose, which is slowly being secreted. So yes, fiber, good result, positive result because of slow blood sugar level increase. And therefore, the insulin, natural insulin, can manage these slow blood sugar level release. Okay, so fiber is good. Sweeteners, the FDA Fasans approved sweeteners are okay. Stevia is also approved by FDA and Fasans, which is a natural sweetener. Erythritol, which comes from plants, which is also considered to be good. Now protein, remember, when we speak about protein, a lot of meat protein, animal protein, they are high in saturated fat. So we have to be careful about that. And therefore you have to have lean protein. Lean protein is good for any individual, okay, a healthy individual or a diabetic individual or an obese individual, the focus is always on lean proteins, okay? So yes, but when you have secondary medical conditions such as diabetic nephropathy, nephro meaning your nephrons are the cells of your kidney. So when you have impaired kidney functioning, that is when you will have to moderate and limit your protein intake, okay? So how does diabetes cause diabetic nephropathy? We will be looking into that very soon. Then you have fats. So with fats, you have, for instance, the healthy type of fats, which have been definitely researched, such as your MUFA, They have good results to show that fats are satiating, okay? And they support a glucose control in type 2 diabetes. And basically how? Because when you have a mixed diet and when you have healthy fats in the diet, you have slower release of glucose into the blood. So the mechanism remains the same, okay? Slow release of glucose into the blood, meaning more time for the natural insulin to manage that slow release of blood glucose. The other mechanism of fat is that omega-3 fat, which has been extensively researched. This is anti-inflammatory, okay? So this will help to bring down your inflammatory levels, to bring down systemic inflammation. So omega-3 has good results with type 2 diabetes as well, because of its anti-inflammatory properties. We are going to be looking at a lot on how omega-3 is an anti-inflammatory agent, but this will be covered in the mental health lecture. All right? So now alcohol. So yes, the guidelines are the same. So guidelines are same for the healthy population. Now, very, very important is that, as you know, for a diabetic individual, the baseline functioning of glucose metabolism is impaired, all right? So with the efficiency, with how you and I can metabolize glucose, okay, so glucose metabolic cycles, all of your glycolysis, gluconeogenesis, all of those, the efficiency with which you and I can do it, that is not done with the same efficiency in a diabetic individual, okay? So their baseline glucose metabolism in itself is impaired. Therefore, they have to be more mindful when they are drinking alcohol. So now when you have a beer and wine, for example, sweet wine, they contain, yes, carbohydrates, and excessive amount of that will definitely cause hyperglycemia when it is eaten with food and lots of drinks. Yes, this can result in hyperglycemia. And alcohol in itself is an appetite stimulant. Therefore, the individual may be likely to overeat. When you are overeating and plus you are drinking, this can result in hyperglycemia. High blood sugar level definitely is not advisable for any diabetic individual. Now, what is ever so not advisable and what is more scary is hypoglycemia. Okay, so hypoglycemia is much more scarier. Why? Because when you have very low blood sugar level, this can increase your risk of the person going into coma and death as well. Okay. And how we will look into that. But yes, if you have a diabetic individual where their baseline glucose metabolism is impaired, okay, that's why the risk is higher. So when this diabetic individual who is drinking a lot of alcohol but not having food, this can result in hypoglycemia. Okay. So now, what is the metabolic pathway for alcohol in the body? Okay. So ETOH is alcohol basically. All right. So when you have alcohol, ethanol, okay. So when you have alcohol, how is it broken down into your liver? Alcohol is broken into acetaldehyde. Okay. And the main coenzyme required over here is nicotinamide dinucleotide, NAD. All right. So you have nicotinamide dinucleotide, which is reduced to NADH plus H, all right? So nicotinamide dinucleotide hydrogen, all right? So now, yes, you need to remember these names. Again, this question is asked to me. Yes, nicotinamide dinucleotide is something you need to remember. And nucleotide dinucleotide, it comes from nisin. Nisin is your B3, B-complex vitamins. So if you're not confident with your food science, your basic nutrients, please look that up. So this, if you see, is a product of your nisin, B3 vitamin, B-complex vitamin. You have B3, nisin. From that comes nicotinamide dinucleotide. All right? So NAD. So ethanol is broken down into acetaldehyde. Now you will learn in the liver lecture that acetaldehyde is a toxic compound. For humans, acetaldehyde can destroy liver cells. Okay, you know how we say, don't drink so much alcohol, it is bad for your liver. Why is it bad for your liver? It is bad for your liver because of acetaldehyde. Because acetaldehyde can destroy your liver cells. This is a toxic molecule. Your liver does not like it. Human liver does not like it. Okay, so alcohol broken down into acetaldehyde Acetaldehyde is broken down into acetate. Again, you require NAD for this, which is reduced to NADH plus H plus. Okay, and acetate is then converted into carbon dioxide and water. Water, which is eliminated as P. And carbon dioxide is what the police checks when you take a random breath test. Okay, so when you have these police officers patrolling and they check you in the car and they ask you to blow into some that unit, that is because they'll be checking the acetate level, because acetate, you have it merges with carbon dioxide and it is released. Higher acetate levels, higher reading of acetate, meaning you are in trouble. Okay, so don't drink and drive. See, this unit has so much to teach you. Okay, even social causes like no drinking, driving. All right, so so you have alcohol, acetaldehyde, acetate, carbon dioxide, water. Now, if you see in this entire cycle, alcohol is not giving you ATP. And as I said, ATP is the human form of energy, adenosine triphosphate. Okay, so alcohol does not produce ATP, which is the human form of energy. Nor does alcohol at the end product give you glucose over here. It is not that carbon dioxide plus water plus two molecules of glucose. No, alcohol is not even giving you glucose. That yes, now you have glucose, which can go into gluconeogenesis and then it can go into the TC and give you energy. No, alcohol will not give you energy. All right. And alcohol will not even give you glucose. So alcohol will not give you energy per se. Alcohol will not give you glucose molecules, which in turn can give you energy. Or else if your blood sugar levels are low, these glucose molecules then can be released into the blood to support blood sugar levels. No. At the end, alcohol, in summary, will not give you energy, will not give you glucose. Okay. And plus, moreover, alcohol is taking the NAD. If you look at the tricarboxylic acid cycle, the TCA cycle, the Krebs cycle, okay? For the body to generate ATP, you need NAD in the TCA cycle. But NAD is not going to the TCA cycle. Why? Because the individual is drinking so much of alcohol that the NAD is devoted for breaking down the alcohol in the body, okay? So NAD is not going to the TCA. So TCA cannot function independently to give you energy. NAD is devoted to the alcohol metabolism. No NAD, no TCA cycle. NAD going for alcohol metabolism. Does that make sense? Okay. So I hope this is very clear. So yes, what happens? So when you have high alcohol intake and when you have very limited food intake or no food intake, just binge drinking, okay, this can result in hypoglycemia. Of course, this is the same thing which will happen in a healthy individual. But remember, in a diabetic individual, the underlying carbohydrate metabolism is already impaired. So whatever effects you see of hypoglycemia, they are much more faster. They are much more detrimental for a diabetic individual. Okay. So yes, what will happen for any individual, be it a diabetic individual or a healthy individual, we all know that we have some stores of glycogen in the liver, okay? And they are the size of your fist, okay? This is roughly what the glycogen stores are there. Okay, so yes, your liver glycogen stores, you will have glycogenolysis. Whenever you have lysis, meaning breakdown, okay? So glycogen being broken down to glucose. Glycogenolysis. So you have glycogen being converted to glucose. All right. But remember, this is only so much. All right. Limited stores. This happens. Then can gluconeogenesis happen? No, it cannot happen. Once your glycogen stores are finished, that is when the person starts going under hypoglycemia. Okay. Because you only had so much glucose, you're not eating. So a lot of glucose is taken for energy production. Some glucose also goes into your blood to increase your blood sugar level, but it is not at all practical and feasible. It is not that much. All right. Majority of that goes into your energy production cycle. Why? Because you're not eating and a lot of energy is being used, metabolic energy, to break down your alcohol. So yes, now what do? Your glycogen stores are over. you are drinking alcohol, ATP cannot happen, tricarboxylic acid cycle cannot happen. There is only so much of glycolysis that can happen secondary to the glycogenolysis. So now the only factor is, can gluconeogenesis happen? What is gluconeogenesis? When fat and protein is converted to glucose, this glucose then can then enter the ATP cycle to give you energy because the person is not eating. Okay. Or else to increase your blood sugar level. But this does not happen. Why does it not happen? For the same reason why tricarboxylic acid cycle cannot happen. Because for gluconeogenesis, you need NAD. Okay. So lactate, in normal conditions now I'm talking about, lactate is converted to pyruvate. Pyruvate can then enter gluconeogenesis. Gluconeogenesis can then produce glucose. Okay. This glucose can then enter the TCA cycle. This is just a normal healthy individual. All right. TCA cycle give you energy. And this glucose can also be released into the blood to increase your blood sugar level. Therefore, you're not in a hypoglycemic condition. However, this does not happen. Okay. So from glycolysis, you have lactate production, FYI, if you were not aware. All right. So now lactate to pyruvate does not happen because this requires NAD. We know NAD is taken up by alcohol metabolism. Okay. So NAD is not available. So yes, this pathway will not take place. Then you have malate, which can also be converted to oxaloacetate. Oxaloacetate can enter the gluconeogenesis, ideally in a healthy individual. But malate to oxaloacetate also requires NAD. And you know NAD is taken up by the alcohol metabolism. So this pathway also does not happen. Okay. What are pyruvate and oxaloacetate? When we say protein, protein converted to glucose is called as gluconeogenesis. What protein? Pyruvate, oxaloacetate. Pyruvate, oxaloacetate, they are carbon skeletons. What are carbon skeletons? When you remove the nitrogen group, when you remove the ammonia group from the amino acids, they become carbon skeletons. Okay, if I were to add amino in this, okay, deamination, transamination, as I said, if biochemistry is weak, please look at the biochemistry cycles for carbohydrate, protein, and fat. When I talk about deamination, it is removal of the ammonia group. Transamination, one amino acid being converted to some other amino acid in the body. I'm talking about deamination. Okay, so when you have deamination, what happens? You have the formation of carbon skeletons. So basically, pyruvate, oxaloacetate are type of carbon skeletons. Therefore, they are called as protein type molecules. Okay, so this is how protein ideally can enter gluconeogenesis and then produce glucose. But this does not happen in an individual who is drinking a lot of alcohol because NAD is not available. Okay. So what is happening? You have high lactate in the body. Okay. Because lactate cannot be converted to pyruvate. Blood levels of lactate increases. This causes lactoacidosis. Lactoacidosis meaning you have high risk of having abdominal cramps, nausea, bloating. We'll talk about the symptoms later. But basically, remember, you have lactoacidosis, high lactate in the blood. All right. Of course, you still have hypoglycemia because you're not producing any glucose. All right. So I hope this makes sense. Okay. Then how can fat support? All right. What is the picture of fat? So ideally, what happens is you have odd chain fatty acids. Odd chain fatty acids are generally available in dairy fats. Okay. Animal fats have even chain fatty acids. Dairy fats have a lot of odd chain fatty acids. Even chain fatty acids, which are there in animal fat, they are bad for you. They have been linked to cardiovascular diseases, heart attack, all of those kind of things. Animal fats, all right? Whereas dairy fats, which has odd chain fatty acids, they have actually shown to promote fat breakdown in the body, beta oxidation in the body. Okay, for instance. And they have shown to increase the leptin sensitivity. Okay, so not impair leptin resistance. So this is just an FYI research for you that odd chain fatty acids coming from dairy, they have positive outcome with your heart health. All right. It is the animal gene fatty acids which are bad. So now when I talk about these fatty acids, these are saturated fatty acids. Okay. So you have saturated fats. So these are odd chain saturated fatty acids and even chain saturated fatty acids. But as you can see over here, not all fatty acids are bad. You have odd chain fatty acids, which recent research has shown can be favorable for your heart health. Okay, we'll talk more about fats in the heart lecture, but this is just an FYI. So now coming back to the point, so you have fat. You have fat, which is broken down into propanoyl-CoA, propanoyl-CoA into succinyl-CoA, succinyl-CoA into malate. And now you know what can happen. Malate can be converted to oxaloacetate. Okay, but can malate be converted to oxaloacetate? Unfortunately, no. Because we don't have that NAD, okay? So gluconeogenesis cannot take place. So this is how fat is converted, say, into a carbon skeleton at the end, and carbon can support in the production of a carbon skeleton, and carbon skeleton can then enter gluconeogenesis. Isn't the body amazing as to how these all molecules are connected, these fat and protein and carbohydrate molecules? I find it really fascinating. Anyways, it's because I really like biochemistry. All right. So gluconeogenesis is not happening. All right. So the bottom line is fat cannot support gluconeogenesis. All right. Because there is lack of NAD. However, what fat can do is fat can break down itself. All right. And give you energy. All right. So breakdown of fat, as you know, is called as beta oxidation. Okay. Which is lipolysis. All right. Which is lysis, meaning breakdown. All right. So yes, fat can break down to give you energy, but it also produces ketone bodies. So this is what I'm talking about. So when you have beta oxidation of fat, it generates acetyl-CoA. Acetyl-CoA can go into the tricarboxylic acid cycle to give you energy. All right. But acetyl-CoA also produces acetoacetate. Okay. Now this acetoacetate can then break down and give you three types of ketone bodies, which is acetone, beta hydroxybutyrate, all right, and acetoacetate. I should have colored this. My bad, guys. Okay, so acetoacetate, acetone, and beta hydroxybutyrate are three types of ketone bodies. Okay, now these ketone bodies, when they are of a higher level in the blood, this then causes ketoacidosis. Another FYI fact which you may want to remember, guys, is that first, anything which is excess in the blood is the last point. Anything which is excess will first saturate your urine, all right? So you will have high, for example, high sugar level in your urine. And then the second indicator will be high blood sugar levels, okay? So anything, any sort of saturation first happens in your urine because the body consciously tries to throw those excessive products out. So when you have high production of your ketone bodies, which is acetoacetate, acetone, and beta hydroxybutyrate, these first saturate the urine. The body tries to throw them out. So you have high ketone bodies in the urine, and then followed after a couple of hours or even after a couple of just minutes, once the urine is saturated, there is no more that the body can throw out. Then your blood starts filling up with those compounds. Okay. Therefore, you have high ketone bodies in your blood, which is called as ketoacidosis. All right. So yes, at the end. I'm sorry. I don't know why the screen sharing stopped. Now I'm the one who's occupying the screen. So just bear with me. I'll just share the PowerPoint again. So I'm sharing the lecture PowerPoint slide. All right. So I hope you can see the slide. I'll just reconfirm. Yes, you can see the slide because it's unfortunate, right? Like you don't want to see me occupying the entire screen. It's important for you to see these lecture slides. Okay. All right. So yes, in summary, what happens? In summary, you have lactoacidosis. Why? Because lactate cannot be converted to glucose via gluconeogenesis because of limited NAD. So you have lactoacidosis in the body. Second, fat is broken down to produce ATP. Okay. So yes, that is happening at the site. But remember, dealing with fat is like having a deal with the Satan. Okay, so it is like making a deal with the devil. So fat will give you energy, but fat will also give you ketone bodies. And when you have high amount of ketone bodies, this results in ketoacidosis. So you have lactoacidosis, you have ketoacidosis, all right? Lactoacidosis, ketoacidosis symptoms are the follows: nausea, vomiting, cramps, headache, tachycardia, irregular heartbeat, which is what it means, shortness of breath, coma, and death, okay? So yes, this can lead to all of that. So hypoglycemia is much more dangerous, as I said, because this can lead to coma and death, secondary to lactoacidosis, ketoacidosis. But why exactly is lactoacidosis, ketoacidosis happening as part of hypoglycemia? Now you know the exact mechanism. So guys, this is what is very important. This unit is the foundation for clinical sciences, especially if you have to do anything with diet and nutrition. All right. So once you understand the underlying mechanisms which are going on in the body, then when you learn how to treat a patient in terms of medical nutritional therapy, which is what we dietitians do, it all makes a lot of sense. Otherwise, if somebody just says, yeah, the patient is experiencing ketoacidosis, you will just not get the connection as to why is the patient experiences ketoacidosis. Why does diabetes, hypoglycemia cause ketoacidosis? That's why understanding these mechanisms are so very much important, because this can help you to convince your patients as to why is it that they are seeing these symptoms. They may be complaining of a lot of cramps and headaches and things, okay, because of, say, their excessive drinking issues, and you see that blood levels are high in ketone bodies. You can show them this entire connection, that these symptoms that they are experiencing, they are not just independent by itself. These symptoms are a outcome of a lot of things which are already undergone in this body, which is your lactoacidosis, ketoacidosis, so on and so forth. Therefore, it is so important to understand these underlying foundation, these underlying sciences, before you start learning how to treat a patient, which is more of a postgraduate thing. Okay? All right. So now you have chromium. So a lot of research has been done in terms of chromium and insulin sensitivity. All right. So I'll walk you through this diagram. Okay. So basically, chromium deficiency is sometimes noted in a diabetic individual, or else if a diabetic individual, just because of dietary reasons and so on and so forth, has chromium deficiency, these individuals are then supplemented with chromium. Okay. So now what is the role of chromium? So this is just the normal thing. So when you have glucose in the blood, these are the glucose channels, meaning they are like gates. Okay. These gates open. Okay. These gates will open. And then you have glucose enter into the cell. When will these gates open? Okay, when will these glucose channel or glucose gate open? When you have the insulin, this diamond shape is the insulin. When it is combined with the insulin receptor, so this V-shaped thing over here is the insulin receptor. And then you have this chromodulin. Okay, so chromodulin is a type of a protein. All right. So now what happens is that when the cell senses that there is glucose and I need to take up glucose, you have insulin, which will get bound to the insulin receptor. Your glucose channels will open. Okay. And you will have some amount of glucose come in. Now, what is the role of chromium? Okay. When you have sufficient amount of chromium in your body, all right. When the chromium senses, oh, the insulin is bound to insulin receptor. Okay, let me make this binding time much more longer and stronger so that all the glucose, the required amount of glucose is what I'm talking about. The required amount of glucose then enters the cell sufficiently. So you have the chromium which enters the blood. When you have glucose start entering into the cell, this is when the chromium uptake from the blood is triggered. So you need to have enough amount of chromium in your blood to be taken up in your cell. Does that make sense? So that's why you don't want chromium deficiency. Okay. So when your cell starts taking glucose, the cell will say, let me take up chromium also, because it will help me to take up as much glucose as I want. Because if the insulin receptor complex separates, then the channels will close and I cannot take up as much glucose as I need. All right. So yes, your chromium will enter into the cell from the blood. Okay, now your chromium will attach to the chromodulin. Okay, and now this chromium chromodulin complex will then attach to the insulin receptor complex. Okay, so this is what chromium does. Chromium helps you to attach these things. Okay, chromium chromodulin complex to the insulin receptor complex. Now the channels will, now this channels will be open for a longer time, sufficient time for the required amount of glucose to be taken up from the blood into the cells. Okay, so basically this is the role of chromium. It creates a stronger complex between the insulin and insulin receptor. Okay, and for a longer time as needed by the cell. All right, so once the cell has sufficient amount of glucose and the cell needs no more, I should have gone like this. I finally just went to this. So yeah, chromium attaches to the chromodulin. Okay, so this is A, B, C. I directly just verbally said it and I didn't show you the diagram. So A, B, C, C is chromium chromodulin. And this complex then attaches to the insulin receptor. All right. And then you have sufficient amount of glucose taken in. Once you have sufficient amount of glucose taken in, this chromium is then released back into the blood. And this chromium is then eliminated from the body in the urine. Okay. And this is dose dependent. If your cells need more amount of glucose, more amount of chromium will be taken into the cell. Then you will have more amount of chromium usage. And then this chromium will be thrown out of the cell into your urine and excreted from your urine. Okay. So you will have high chromium levels in the urine. Okay. If it's been used like this. All right. So the problem happens in a diabetic individual when they don't have sufficient amount of chromium in their blood. If they have chromium deficiency, the body in a diabetic individual may also try using a lot more chromium as compared to, say, a healthy individual, because in a healthy individual, the insulin receptor complex is naturally much more stronger. But as you know, in a diabetic individual, because of decreased insulin sensitivity, increased insulin resistance, the body has to work twice more harder to have this complex, okay? Efficient complex. Therefore, chromium helps to improve the efficiency of this complex. So the chromium usage has also seen to be higher in diabetic individuals, all right? If the usage is higher, definitely then you have the need is also higher. So if you see in the blood reports that the diabetic individual is suffering from chromium deficiency, certainly this should trigger an advice that that individual may benefit from chromium supplements. Okay, but this is not your call to take. This is done as a more multidisciplinary team. Okay, this decision making. All right, so now you have magnesium. What is the role of magnesium in increasing insulin sensitivity? So again, this the way it is explained, see guys, if you see, I have drawn a lot of flow charts, all right, in my slides. And this is my practice, because if I were to just show you the research article and I tell you, okay, I'm just going to verbally explain this, you look at this research article and this is there in your exam, you will freak out. Because the way it is written in a research article is much more complex, and it may not be, you may not be able to digest it that easily as it is when you have a visual diagram in front of you. So that's why the use of a lot of flow charts, and therefore encouraging you to write your answers in exams in terms of flow chart and bullet points to keep it simple, to come to the point, to make it easier for you. Okay, so at the end, remember guys, paragraphs are not going to give you marks. Science is going to give you marks. As long as you have the content right, even if it is written in a flow chart, that's going to give you a mark. All right, so that's the kind of person I am. I don't look at 4 pages of answer. I look at, does she have the sciences right? Or does he have the sciences right? Okay, I'm more of a content person. All right, so yes, now coming to magnesium. So now what is the role of magnesium? All right, so now again, when you have glucose floating in the blood and your cell, the cell inside, the cell needs this glucose, what will it do? It will trigger magnesium from the blood to come into your cell. Okay, so again, the condition applies. You should have sufficient amount of magnesium in your blood for it to be taken up in your cell. All right. So when the body senses that, I am in need of glucose, when the cell senses that I'm in need of glucose, let me take some glucose from the blood. So it will ask magnesium, magnesium come into the cell, magnesium will come into the cell. Now when magnesium comes into the cell, two people go out of the cell, which are your calcium and your sodium. Okay, so this always happens. It's automatic. Okay, they flow in inverse direction. So when magnesium comes in the cell, sodium and calcium goes out of the cell. All right. And then when magnesium comes into the cell, then what happens? Okay, now this is important. So magnesium activates an enzyme which is called as tyrosine kinase. Okay. Tyrosine kinase then further activates phosphate. Okay. Now this phosphate makes the insulin receptor complex much more stronger. Okay. The same thing. It makes it stronger and it helps the glucose channels to be open for a longer period of time. Okay. So because the glucose channels are open for a longer period of time, the glucose then can enter, sufficient amount of glucose can then enter into the cell. Okay. But magnesium therefore is so important because it is a very important nutrient, all right, to activate your tyrosine kinase. Okay. And tyrosine kinase in turn activates phosphate. Phosphate therefore makes the insulin receptor complex stronger. The gates are open for a longer time. Okay. So yes, magnesium, in summary, decreases insulin resistance. It increases insulin sensitivity. So now what happens when you have magnesium deficiency? Now remember, your blood always has to be maintained at a certain homeostatic level, meaning your body will say it is okay to have deficiency inside the cell, but I need to maintain an equilibrium in the blood. Okay, meaning the nutrients need to be at a balanced level in your blood. When the nutrients are less in your blood, they are already less in your cell. And there is no more that the body can take from the cell and throw in your blood. So for example, when you have iron deficiency, it means that your cells are already deprived of iron. There is no more iron that the cells can throw out into the blood for you to maintain your blood iron levels. And therefore, now you are showing symptoms of iron deficiency anemia. Just to show you the visual example of it. Okay. Similarly, when you have magnesium deficiency, the body's first priority is to maintain blood levels of magnesium. Why is it so important to maintain nutrient levels in the blood, guys? It's a very simple concept. Remember, blood is the only thing which can flow all over in your body. Okay, so it can go into your brain, into your toes. Blood is the only fluid, the only compound which can travel. You don't have your stomach which is traveling all over your body, right? Blood is the only fluid which can flow all over your body. So yes, it is very important for us to maintain the nutrient levels in your blood well, all right? Because that is the one which is flowing all over in your body. So in magnesium deficiency, what is happening? Yes, you have magnesium, which is taken from the cell and it is thrown into the blood because our priority is to maintain blood magnesium levels first. Okay. You know, if magnesium goes out into the blood, the automatic response is for calcium and sodium to come into the cell. All right. So now when calcium comes into the cell and when you have excessive amount of calcium coming into the cell, okay, remember, when you have excessive amount of calcium and sodium entering the cell, what does this cause? This causes vasoconstriction, all right? So it will narrow your blood vessels and this will increase your blood pressure, all right? Excessive amount of calcium into these cells, into the organelles, can result in calcification of your organs. Therefore, your organs are then more, they are not that viable, okay? They are not that soft and tangible, okay? Because they are hardened now. So you have hard arteries, you have constricted arteries. This will increase your blood pressure, okay? This is how you will see probably a diabetic, one of the reasons, there are many reasons, okay? One of the reasons why a diabetic individual may have high blood pressure, it could be because of magnesium deficiency, the electrolyte deficiency. Therefore, very important to check the blood levels of electrolytes in a diabetic individual. All right. So I hope this makes sense, these mechanisms. So now moving to the nutrients, as I said, so definitely check for, obviously you'll be checking for many other things as a dietitian. But in terms of pathophysiological mechanisms, the ones which have been extensively researched are chromium and magnesium. So definitely check for them. And if they are deficient, then yes, you need to consult with the multidisciplinary team whether supplementation would be beneficial. Okay. Why am I saying that consult with the multidisciplinary team, consult with it. You can't be the only one making these decisions, because you have to consider the patient's secondary underlying medical conditions as well. All right. If the patient has a diabetic neuropathy, nephropathy, there are many other complications to consider. Okay. So I won't go into the details of all those, because that is more part of medical nutritional therapy. All right. But yeah. Hope it makes sense. Okay, this is a long lecture. So now even my mouth is drying. I need to have some water. So please bear with me. Okay. Okay. So now you have diabetic gastroparesis. Now, what is diabetic gastroparesis? We'll come to that in one of the few slides very soon. But remember, very, very basic, fundamental. What does diabetic gastroparesis means is that, you know how your stomach has a motion action, okay? So your stomach will contract and relax, and it will be basically having some movements when it is trying to digest the food, okay? So when your stomach is trying to digest the food, it has some movements, and then it pushes the food forward, all right? Then the food goes into the pyloric sphincter, and then from that, it goes into your duodenum, okay? So yes, your stomach has this movements, and with this peristaltic movement, the food is pushing forward, and then it goes into the duodenum. But what happens in diabetic gastroparesis, these movements which the stomach is making, the peristaltic movement, these are impaired. Okay, so the food is just sitting over there stationary, all right? So that can cause a lot of complications and symptoms, which we'll talk about later. But when you have such a condition, the type of diet that the dietitian generally recommends is a soft to liquid diet. A low-fat diet. Why? Because then it's easier to digest. When you have high-fat diet, the food sits in your stomach for a longer time. A low-fiber diet as well, all right? Small, frequent meals, so you don't have a lot of food in your stomach at one time. So they have very small, frequent meals rather than, say, a big lunch and a big dinner. That's not advisable. Okay, so this all strategies, they support gastric emptying. Low fiber diet, low seed diet. So anything which is seedy, like tomatoes, they have seeds. All right. So that may help as well, because anything which is complex, like a high fiber diet, seeds, this will take more time to digest. A high fat diet as well. All right. So these are the strategies or the recommendations which are done for diabetic gastroparesis. Soft diet or liquid diet only, low fat diet, low fiber diet, low seed diet, and to aid in gastric emptying, and therefore small frequent meals as well. So then you have hypoglycemia. So as I said, hypoglycemia is one of the main symptoms which is seen in a diabetic individual when their blood sugar levels are low. So the most important thing to do is to give them quick source of glucose. Now, the details of this has been provided in your pre-readings. Okay, so one of your pre-reading slide is all about management of hypoglycemia in very simplistic terms. All right, so that is something which is part of your pre-reading. So please look into that. And remember, as I have said previously many times, yes, your pre-readings, because they are not research articles, they are accessible for your exams. Okay, so your pre-readings are accessible for your exams. Okay, so now moving forward, you have complications of diabetes. So now we are going to cover complications of diabetes. You have hypoglycemia. As I said, this is part of your pre-reading, which is the acute complication of diabetes. So when you have low blood sugar levels, the quickest thing and the first thing which happens is you have the acute complication called hypoglycemia, low blood sugar level. So please look at your pre-readings for that again. So now I'm going to talk about diabetic ketoacidosis. Now, guys, the slides which are in blue color, okay, meaning I have a diagram for those slides. This slide basically is what I have written down in this slide. Does that make sense? Okay. So I have taken the writing of these slides and I have converted it into a diagram, because diagram is visual, it's easy to understand, and it will be much more easier for you even if you have to write it in your exams. Okay. So now, as I said, we are talking about the other complication in a diabetic individual, acute complication, which is called as ketoacidosis. All right. So both conditions, hyperglycemia as well as hypoglycemia, can produce ketoacidosis. How? We'll look at the mechanisms. All right. So in a hypoglycemic individual, all right, what happens? In a hypoglycemic individual, how does this result in hypoglycemia first? Okay. And therefore ketoacidosis. So when does hypoglycemia happen? When you have less food intake and you may have high insulin or high oral hypoglycemic agents, which is the medication which type 2 diabetic individual are prescribed, such as metformin, for them to regulate their blood sugar levels, for them, for their pancreas to be more activated so that they release sufficient amount of insulin. Okay. So these are called as oral hypoglycemic agents. Okay. So this OHGA is oral hypoglycemic agents. All right. So when you have less food intake, but this happens especially when a individual is newly diagnosed with type 1 diabetic, and they may accidentally take more insulin than required, and their food intake is less compared to the insulin which is taken, or their food intake may be normal, but they have accidentally taken double dose of insulin, okay, or the wrong type of insulin. All right. So yes, and in a type 2 individual, as I said, type 2 individual, they may have taken greater amount of oral hypoglycemic agents complemented with less food. Okay. Or else even in type 2 diabetic individuals, if their blood sugar levels are very, very high and they are suffering from complication, they are also put on insulin. Okay. So they may have both of these things. They may have insulin as well as they may have oral hypoglycemic agents. Okay. So then what is happening? Then you have basically what happens, because you have so much of insulin in the blood, you have so much of oral hypoglycemic agent triggering endogenous production of insulin. Okay. So you have high insulin or you have high glucose, which is going inside your cell. Okay. Because of the high insulin, because of the high oral hypoglycemic agents, you have high amount of glucose, which is going inside your cell. So inside the cell, you have high glucose, but in the blood, you have low glucose. So this is essentially called as hypoglycemia. Okay. So you have low blood sugar levels. All right. Then what happens, as you know, whenever you have hypoglycemia, you can only have so much amount of glycogenolysis, meaning glycogen being converted to glucose. Okay. There is only so much that can happen. Then what will happen? Then you have fat, which is broken down for energy. So yes, fat undergoes beta oxidation. It will give you energy, which is your ATP. But remember, dealing with fat is like making a deal with the devil, because fat will give you ketone bodies. Okay. So now when you have ketone bodies being produced, this leads to high ketoacidosis. Now, this is how hypoglycemia results in high ketoacidosis. Does that make sense? Is this very clear? It's very simple. If you see, the mechanisms are very simple, but because a lot of you may be learning it for the first time, so you will need to go through these mechanisms a couple of times, and then they'll become like the back of your hand. They become really easy. Okay. Because see, it's the best thing about pathophysiological mechanisms is that you don't have to memorize them. You have to understand them. The more you understand them, guys, the easier they will be for you, and you will be able to retain them for a long run. Okay. If you try to memorize this, yes, you will pass your exams. But next year, if you enter a postgraduate course, such as say nutrition and dietetics, and if you will forget these mechanisms, okay, and forget it in the long run. If you have a diabetic patient sitting in front of you, you need understanding, not memorization. understanding takes you in the long run. Okay. So yes, that's again my tip for the day. I keep giving a lot of tips in my lectures. All right. So one very, very important tip: nutrition and disease is a subject which you need to understand, not memorize. Okay. Of course, certain level of memorization goes into every subject, but what I'm trying to say is concepts need to be understood. Once you understand thing, then memorize it. Okay. But if you don't understand, if you are just memorizing, this is the step, this is what is happening, but if you don't know why it is happening, yeah, good luck with becoming a health professional. Okay, it will be very tough. All right, so understand the concepts. So now moving to hyperglycemia. Okay, so now how hyperglycemia leads to ketoacidosis is what we are trying to cover over here. So now with hyperglycemia, it's the... Again, it's the opposite thing, which is you have a high amount of food intake. Okay, so you have taken, you have eaten a lot of food, but you have taken less insulin, or else you have forgotten to take your oral hypoglycemic agent medication. Okay, so you had, say, a big dinner, or else you had a big lunch, but you forgot to take your insulin dose, or else you have taken accidentally a lower dose of insulin, or else you forgot to take your medication. Okay. So now what happens? You have high glucose in the blood. Okay. So you have a lot of glucose which is floating in your blood. Yeah, this is my floating action. Okay. So you have a lot of glucose which is floating in your blood, which cannot enter the cell. Okay. Why it cannot enter the cell is because you don't have any insulin. Okay. And because you forgot to take your medicine, or else you took a less dose of your medicine or less dose of your insulin, you don't have a lot of insulin to bind to the insulin receptor complex so the glucose can go in the cell. Okay, there is no insulin, and you know insulin is the only carrier for glucose. Okay, so yes, in the cell, you will have less glucose. Okay, but you will have a lot of blood sugar levels in your blood. Okay, but what is the use? All right. You know your ATP cycle, metabolic cycles cannot take place in the blood, right? You don't have the TCA cycle happening in the blood. TCA cycles happens in the mitochondria. Mitochondria is one of the organelle systems of your cell, all right? Does that make sense? This is how, guys, this is how you need to remember things. Why do I remember these things? Is because I always backtrack it. Okay, so like why low blood sugar levels are in the cell, not low blood sugar levels in the blood, but why low glucose levels in the cell is scary, because you will not have the TCA cycle happening, because the TCA cycle happens in the mitochondria, which is part of the cell. Okay, so even if there is so much of glucose in the blood, it's of no use to me if I don't have enough insulin, because I cannot use up that glucose. Okay, so yes, you have hyperglycemia. You have hyperglycemia, but your cells are starving. It's such an irony, right? So you have so much of resources, but you still have the cells which are starving, okay? So sometimes I think of this as developed versus developing countries. Like in developed countries, you have so much of food wastage in developed countries. Like for instance, like, you know, you may have a lot of plate waste going on, but then you have on the same planet Earth, you have developing countries where people are dying of starvation, okay? Like in Ethiopia, like in, say, many, many rural villages and tribal communities in India, people are dying of starvation, but on the same planet Earth, you have so much of wastage which is going on, right? So same irony is existing in your body. You have so much of sugar in the blood, but you have hardly any in the cell, and therefore your cells are starving. Because your cells are starving, fat is broken down for energy, which gives you ATP via beta oxidation. Of course, then you have ketone bodies, which are released. Ketone bodies meaning ketoacidosis, and therefore hyperglycemia also results in ketoacidosis. Does that make sense? Okay. So guys, in this simplistic manner, it is not explained in the textbooks. It is not explained in the research article. When I make these diagrams, I have read 10 textbooks, 10 research articles, taken the latest evidence and summarized it, collated it in form of these diagrams, in form of these flowcharts. Okay. That's why if you see these lectures are so unique, because it's not a copy paste of any textbook or a research article. All right. Okay, so guys, again, these are blue color slides. Blue color slides meaning there is a diagram following it. Okay, so now I'm going to explain you two concepts, dawn phenomena and Somogyi effect. Remember for now that dawn phenomena and Somogyi effect, this is very likely, and the prevalence of dawn phenomena and Somogyi effect is much more in a type 1 individual rather than a type 2 individual. It's not that you don't see it in a type 2 individual, but in a type 2 individual, you still have some insulin production. There is still some natural management of glucose happening. But in a type 1 individual who is completely dependent on external insulin, that is where you see the concepts of dawn phenomena and Somogyi effect. Okay? So now, we'll go into the differences for the same. So dawn phenomena and Somogyi effect. So now, basically, in dawn phenomena, during the pre-dawn time. Okay, so what is pre-dawn? It is between 2 a.m. to 3 a.m. Okay, so when it is 2 a.m. to 3 a.m., what is it that you see? You see hyperglycemia. Okay, in dawn phenomena, between 2 a.m. to 3 a.m. at night. Okay, so like in the morning, basically, but we are sleeping at that time. Okay, generally normal people. All right, so yes, at night, 2 a.m. to 3 a.m., you will see that the individual has hyperglycemia, okay? But in Somogyi effect, between 2 a.m. to 3 a.m., generally speaking, you see hypoglycemia, okay? So that is where this especially happens in the early stages of type 1 diabetes, when the individual is still trying to learn and trying to identify their insulin dosage and insulin response, okay? So when they are still trying to set into a pattern as to what insulin dosage will be best for them, that is when they generally see this. Therefore, the doctors will, their GPs will ask the individual to wake up between 2 a.m. to 3 a.m. and test their blood sugar levels, because that will help to differentiate whether the individual is suffering from dawn phenomena or whether the individual is suffering from Somogyi effect. And depending upon what they are suffering from, their insulin to food ratio will then be adjusted for, all right? Because at the end, if you see at 8 a.m. in the morning, okay, at 8 a.m. in the morning, both in dawn phenomena and in Somogyi effect, the individual will see hyperglycemia, okay? The reason for hyperglycemia is different, and we'll be covering that. But remember, if you were just to wake up in the morning and check your blood sugar level, okay, a type 1 individual, and then they see, oh, they are suffering from hyperglycemia, they may get worried that, oh, this happened because I didn't take enough amount of insulin at night. I will take more amount of insulin at night. No, it's not as simple as that. Okay. But basically in the morning, you will only see hyperglycemia. But this hyperglycemia, is it because of Somogyi effect or dawn effect, is what the GP will try to identify. And therefore, the GP will ask the patient to wake up at between 2 a.m. and 3 a.m. Okay. So, all right. So, what happens in dawn phenomena? All right. In a type 1 individual, generally, yes, you have eaten the right types and amounts of food. Okay. But you have taken very less insulin, or else you forgot to take your insulin dose. All right. So, you have eaten food, but you don't have sufficient amount of insulin with it. Okay. And in a type 2 individual, if this is seen, then yes, you have eaten food, but you forgot to take your medication, or else your endogenous production of insulin is very less, and the medicines which you have taken is also very less. It's not sufficient to trigger enough amount of endogenous production of insulin. All right, so you may have either forgotten to take your medicines, or else you took very less dose of it, or else if type 2 individual are on insulin and medication management, maybe they forgot to take their insulin or took only one of each. Basically, at the end, the conclusion is the insulin factor, medication factor is less, and therefore the sugar level is high in the blood. So when they wake up between 2 a.m. to 3 a.m., they see hyperglycemia. There's a lot of glucose which is there in the blood floating, okay? But not enough of insulin, all right? There is a lot of glucose which is floating in the blood, and therefore when they wake up in the morning, what they see is you have hyperglycemia, but this is secondary to external glucose. Okay, secondary to external glucose, meaning you have eaten so much, there is so much of glucose which is coming from the diet, okay? But you don't have sufficient amount of insulin or medication, all right? So that is the condition. Now what is happening in Somogyi effect? Somogyi effect, when you have a type 1 individual, they have not eaten sufficiently, or else they ate sufficiently, but they took more amount of insulin. Remember, type 1 individual, as I said, generally this is seen during the early stages, meaning they are still learning to adjust their doses and they may have accidentally done some mistakes, okay? So they took more amount of insulin, but they only ate the regular amount what they are eating, or else they ate much more less than that, okay? All right? So yes, so they have taken more insulin. Over here, it's the opposite. More insulin, but less food, all right? And in type 2 individual, what happened? Yes, you may have skipped a meal, or else you did not eat sufficiently, something like that. But then you have your endogenous production of insulin, which is happening, all right? And plus, maybe you have even taken your oral hypoglycemic agent, which, see guys over here, which I have not written over here, okay? But yes, in this individual, they may have skipped a meal, they may have eaten very less, but they have endogenous production of insulin, plus it is complemented with the medication, or else if they are on an insulin regimen, they may have taken the insulin as well. So over here, basically what is happening, the insulin component is high, the glucose component is low, okay? So yes, you have less glucose, but you have high insulin in the blood, all right? So whenever you have high insulin in the blood, what will the insulin do? It will take up all of that glucose and it will throw it in the cell, okay? So yes, now your cell have metabolized all of that glucose, but now your blood is starving of glucose. It's the opposite thing. Now the blood is starving of glucose, okay? Firstly, the blood is less in glucose because firstly, it may be that you haven't eaten enough, okay? Or else you did eat enough, but you took so much amount of insulin, so much amount of medication that all of that glucose has been transported into your cell long ago. It's been metabolized. And now we are again on square one, which is your blood is starving of glucose, okay? So then what happens? You know that hypoglycemia is something that the body does not like. You need to maintain your nutrient levels in the blood. So your body will not tolerate hypoglycemia. Okay, but remember, this hypoglycemia is because you had lots of insulin, less glucose in the food. Okay, so less glucose basically. All right, so then what happens? Then the internal metabolic cycles will start triggering in the cell, meaning you'll have glycolysis. Okay, and to give you glucose, which is thrown in the blood, you will have endogenous production of glucose, all right? You will have gluconeogenesis. This N-E-O, neo is gluconeogenesis. So you'll have protein and fat, which are converted into glucose. So your blood glucose levels can be maintained. Therefore, you will have high glucose in the blood. But remember, this glucose in the blood now was produced because of internal production of glucose, okay? It was not because your diet was high in glucose. No, it was because in the night time, you had internal production of glucose because of the metabolic cycles. Therefore, now when you're waking up, you are having high amount of glucose in the blood, okay? Whereas over here, hyperglycemia is because of external glucose, because of the food which you have eaten, but less amount of insulin. Over here, hyperglycemia is because of internal glucose, meaning high amount of glucose which is produced in your cells in your body to combat the hypoglycemia which you experienced in the early morning times. Okay? So therefore, what would be the management? The management in dawn phenomena for type 1 diabetes, as I said, it starts with less insulin, right? So the main thing over here is to manage the insulin and the food ratio, okay? So firstly, to eat sufficient amount, not to eat less amount, all right? And the type of insulin may be managed, meaning you may have long-lasting insulin taken at night time, so there is gradual flow of insulin in the blood, okay? But very, very importantly, you cannot not eat. So there is the food which is eaten is fine, But the insulin dosage over here is essentially managed. Meaning, for example, long-lasting insulin provided at nighttime. Okay? So in type 2 diabetic individual, what is managed is carbohydrate loading throughout your meal, which is carbohydrate counting or carbohydrate loading, which I'll not go into the details of, and taking sufficient amount of medications with the food. Okay, so over here, remember the management all depends upon this little box over here, which is over here, you need to regulate your insulin dosage. For instance, long-lasting insulin taken at nighttime, all right? And over here in type 2 diabetic individual, you need to take sufficient amount of medications, okay? So you need to do this, all right? So now when we come on to the Somogyi effect, what needs to be done is, firstly, over here, the issue was that you were not eating enough, okay? In most of the cases, that is what happens. So yes, the first thing is, please eat, okay? In Somogyi effect, please eat, all right? And then you need to manage your insulin dosage with what you eat, yes. And if you are, when you're eating enough, you will need to have your medications, your oral hypoglycemic agents, or else it would be just the endogenous production of insulin if the diabetes is maintained well. That depends. But basically, guys, management is something which you don't have to worry about. And remember, a lot of type 1 diabetic management and even type 2 diabetic management in some instance is done with the diabetic educator. All right, but diabetic educator plays a very, very important role in managing the insulin doses with the carbohydrate loading that the dietitian would do. Carbohydrate loading, the dietitian would say XYZ amount of carbohydrate throughout the day. The diabetic educator would manage the insulin throughout the day for the diabetic individual and the type of insulin as well. So diabetic educator and the diabetes dietitian, they work very closely together. Okay. So I hope this is clear, Dawn phenomena and Somogyi effect. Okay. So now moving to chronic diabetic complications where you have macrovascular complications. So one of the biggest complications you see in a diabetic individual, macrovascular. Macrovascular meaning where your big blood vessels are affected, okay, like your arteries, all right? Arteries, veins, things, which you can, you know, easily see your arteries over here, all right? So macrovascular complications include metabolic syndrome, secondary to insulin resistance. Metabolic syndrome is a cluster of disease which has dyslipidemia, hypertension, atherosclerosis. Hypertension, you know, one of the reasons for hypertension in a diabetic individual could be because of magnesium deficiency. Atherosclerosis could be because of inflammation as well, secondary to insulin resistance. But I'll talk more about metabolic syndrome in the next lecture, in your cardiac lecture. Okay, not over here, but just remember, one of the most common macrovascular complications in a diabetic individual is metabolic syndrome, or else they may independently have dyslipidemia, hypertension, atherosclerosis as well. I'll be going through the macrovascular complications in further detail. What is microvascular complication? Microvascular complication is when you have glycosylation of your small blood vessels. So you have tiny capillaries, okay? So like similarly to the concept of heart, you know how when you have fat layers, plaque, okay, or fatty streaks, when you have plaque in your artery, it clogs your artery, right, in simple layman terms. And that is when you have your fat buildup in your artery and therefore you have a heart attack, right? Similarly, glycosylation of blood vessels means you have glucose molecules which are accumulated in your small, fine capillaries, all right? So in your microvascular capillaries, okay, which you need a microscope to see, therefore they are microvascular, you have accumulation of glucose molecule, and this is called as glycosylation of blood vessels. So when you have tiny capillaries, say in your fingertips, which gives you these sensations, therefore you can feel something when you are rubbing your fingers, all right? So there are microcapillaries over here, okay? Now, when these microcapillaries are glycosylated, when they are glycosylated, then what happens? Your sensation is numbed. When your sensation is numbed, even when you cut your finger, you may not feel the pain because you don't have that pain sensation, okay? All those microcapillaries, they are clogged. In layman term, they are clogged because of glucose. And remember, when you have microcapillaries which are glycosylated, all right? And when you have, you cannot sense it secondary to glycosylation. Now when you have a cut, and when that cut is exposed to the environment, bacteria love glucose, they will infest it. You will have sepsis. If sepsis is not taken care of, that will go into gangrene, and gangrene may require amputations. Make sense? You see how all of this is connected? Okay. So now we'll go through various microvascular complications, but remember the underlying cause being glycosylations of your small blood vessels. Okay, so the first microvascular complication which is seen in a diabetic individual is nephropathy. Okay, so what is nephropathy? Nephrons are the cells of your kidney. Okay, nephro. Okay, nephro meaning cells of your kidney, nephrons. Nephropathy. Okay, so nephropathy is when you have impairment of your kidney cells. Okay, so when you have glycosylation of your kidney cells, nephrons, then what happens? The first symptom which you see is microalbuminuria, meaning you have small size protein loss in your urine. See, healthy individuals like you and me will not lose protein. Protein is such a valuable nutrient to the body, which I think I explained to you even in the last lecture. Only thing which has nitrogen, only nutrient which can help in the building of your muscles, in generating of your cells. Okay, carbohydrate and fat cannot do that. All right, they have other important functions. So your body does not like to lose protein, okay? But yes, the first symptom which you see in nephropathy is microalbuminuria. You're losing small cells, small protein cells. Then you have macroalbuminuria, meaning large protein cells are lost. Why is this happening? Because you have glycosylation of your glomerulus filtrate. If you do not remember physiology, that's why physiology is also so very much important for this unit, guys. Okay, so when you look at physiology, you look at the cell structure of your nephrons, which are the cells of your kidney. You have your glomerulus, okay, which is like that pouch sort of a thing. That is where all that filtration happens. Glomerulus is like a sieve, it's like a filter. It filters all the protein. It does not let protein pass in the urine. That protein is taken back in the blood. It takes all the other toxic compounds like urea, ammonia, anything else, and it throws it out of the kidney. It throws it out in the urine. Okay, so that is why glomerulus is so important. Now, glomerulus is made up of fine microcapillary. Okay, but now you know you have glycosylation of this microcapillary, meaning you have glycosylation of your glomerulus. All right, therefore, you have a decreased GFR rate. Glomerulus filtrate rate, meaning you have decreased urinary output. When you have decreased urinary output, you then go to chronic kidney disease. You have various stages of chronic kidney disease. Depending upon the urinary output, which is one of the indicator, not the only indicator, but I won't go into the details of that because that's medical nutritional therapy. So depending upon the urinary filtrate rate, your chronic kidney disease output, your chronic kidney disease stage can be classified. All right. When you have no urinary output, okay, you have aurea, meaning zero urinary output. Your kidney glomerulus glycosylation is so bad that your kidney cells are dead. They cannot produce any more urine. That is when you have kidney failure. That is when you go on dialysis. Okay. Dialysis is like you have an external machine which acts like the kidney for you. Basically, what's the function of kidney? To purify your blood, to take all the crap from your blood and to throw it in the urine. When your kidney cannot do that, the machine will do it for you. Of course, it impairs your quality of life. That's not natural. And it's very painful as well because you have catheters inserted in your system and things. I won't go in details of that. That is a different subject altogether, medical nutritional therapy. Okay, so basically just a general overview. In these individuals who have diabetic nephropathy, they may be advised a low protein diet because they do not have sufficient kidney capacity to process and eliminate the ammonia converted into urea and throw it out as urine. Okay, and you know protein is all about ammonia. All right, so the nitrogen group converted into ammonia and then urea. When you don't have that capacity, you cannot your when your kidney capacity is lost, that is when you go on a low protein diet. These individuals will also have a low potassium diet. Why? Because the kidney functioning is impaired. You're not throwing out the electrolytes. Remember the basic thing which you learned in food science, excessive amount of electrolytes can be thrown out in the urine from the body. Okay, so the excessive amount of electrolytes are like your sodium, potassium, magnesium, all of these are thrown out in the from the urine. Okay, but unfortunately, your kidney filtration function is lost in nephropathy. So then what happens? You have less excretion of potassium. You have high potassium in your blood. Very high potassium in the blood is very scary because it leads to hyperkalemia. Okay, so hyperkalemia meaning high potassium in the blood, which can lead to myocardial infarction, MI. Okay, so heart attack basically. Okay, because when you have high potassium, it impairs your functioning of your heart muscles, and this can lead to heart attack. Okay, so you don't want that. So individuals with nephropathy, they are on a low protein diet, they are on a low potassium diet, they are even on a low phosphorus diet. Okay, there are many, many other factors to consider in nephropathy when you are, say, planning medical diets for these individuals. We are not going to go into the details of that. That's medical nutritional therapy. So yes, low phosphorus in diet. Again, why? Because as I said, your body cannot throw out the excess amount of phosphorus via urine. So what is this excess phosphorus in the blood? If you have excess phosphorus in the blood, what will happen? It will leach out calcium from the bones. Okay. Therefore, it will lead to osteoporosis. And all that extra calcium which is floating in your blood, it will start settling down into your blood vessels, into your soft tissue. And therefore, it will cause calcification of soft tissue. This is again what I spoke about when I was talking about magnesium and diabetes in the earlier slides. Okay. And that is why it is not favorable. So that's why you have a low phosphorus diet as well. Of course, one of the main medical management which you do in this is they are on diuretics. All right. That is if the kidney is functioning. If the kidney is not functioning, you can't do anything. Then it is just dialysis, meaning aureia, when you have aureia. Okay. But yes, they have a very, very delicate medical management. And this case becomes very, very difficult when you have a diabetic individual who has heart problem and who has kidney problem. And there are lots of cases where a diabetic individual will have heart plus kidney problem. Heart, remember, macrovascular complications of diabetes involves heart diseases such as atherosclerosis, dyslipidemia, hypertension. Okay. So if you just had an individual with heart disease, potassium is very good for those individuals. Sodium is not good for those individuals. All right. But as you know, in kidney disease, potassium is not good for kidney disease. So you see how the nutrients are opposite. Only heart disease, potassium is good. Only kidney disease, potassium is bad. But when you have heart and kidney disease, the medical management becomes very complicated. Okay, because you have to go low sodium because of heart. You have to go low potassium because of kidney. You have to go low on other electrolytes because of kidney as well. You have to go low on protein as well. The one nutrient which is key in modulating this is fat, healthy fats, because that is the one which interferes less. Of course, when you have a diabetic individual, carbohydrate metabolism is completely impaired. You have to take care of carbohydrate. With kidney, you have to take care of protein in terms of macronutrients. With kidney, you have to take care of electrolytes. Certain electrolytes are opposite when you have heart and kidney going on at the same time. The only nutrient you are left with is fat. This becomes more difficult in a developing countries where you don't have feeds, enteral feeds, parenteral feeds, which are catered for a kidney disease. Okay, so I won't go into that. That is a very, very big science in itself, medical nutritional therapy. But yes, when I have worked in developing countries where you don't have feeds, then the only nutrient you modulate majorly is with fat in this condition. Okay, but there's only so much you can do with fat as well. But yeah, I'll just stop over there because I'm so tempted to start talking about medical nutritional therapy at this moment. I'll go on to retinopathy. So now retinopathy, as the name suggests, retino meaning eyes. Okay, retinopathy. So when you have glycosylation of the microcapillaries in your eyes happening, that is when you have retinopathy, okay? So the first stage of glycosylation of microcapillaries in your eyes is called as glycoma, okay? Glycosylation of the existing blood vessels in your eyes, that is called as glycoma, okay? When you have these glucose settled down in the blood vessels of your eyes, these blood vessels, they start swelling, okay? Because they want to increase their surface area. Because there is so much of glucose settling down in them, they do not have sufficient space for the blood to flow in the from one side to the other end. Okay, so that's why these blood vessels, they start swelling. This is called as aneurysm. Okay, meaning you have swelling of blood vessels. All right, first stage is glycoma, glycosylation of your blood vessels. This results in aneurysm, which is swelling of your blood vessels. Then what happens? The blood vessels can only swell up to so much point. Then you may have breakage of these blood vessels. This is called as hemorrhage. Okay, so blood vessel hemorrhage. So when your blood vessels inside your eyes, they break, okay, then these individuals generally, they complain of seeing black spots when they are looking at things. So when they are looking at things, they may see black spots in their vision. These black spots are basically blood patches because their blood vessels are breaking, okay? And therefore, what the reflection, what they see in the retina is those blood vessels which are breaking, so they are blood spots, okay? Then what happens? The blood vessels which may, for example, break, they may die at the end, or even if they are not broken because of so much of glycosylation of the blood vessels, there is no nutrient and oxygen flowing to the other end because there is so much of glucose deposit in the between. Therefore, these blood vessels may start dying. So the blood vessels may start dying because of glycosylation in itself. The blood vessels may start dying because of hemorrhage as well. And this leads to necrosis, meaning death of the blood vessels, death of the cells. Okay. And because these existing blood vessels are dying, then you have new blood vessels or microcapillaries which are forming in your eyes. This leads to a big wire mesh, okay? And these microcapillaries, they are just, developing anywhere and everywhere, okay, to bring some blood supply into your eyes. This creates a big wire mesh, okay? And this wire mesh becomes so dense finally that it covers your vision, and therefore this can result in blindness. So diabetes can result in blindness because of glycosylation of the blood vessels. Okay. All right. Then you have neuropathy, which is when you have glycosylation of your nerve endings, of your neurons. So neurons are the cells of your brain. Okay. So when you have glycosylation of your cells of your brain happening, the nervous system will get affected. Always remember, nephrons and neurons cannot be regenerated in humans, okay? Right now, our stem cell technology is not that advanced that we can regenerate naturally, organically, the stem cells of our brain and of our kidney. So once they are dead, they are gone forever, okay? So yes, in neuropathy, you have glycosylation of your neurons happening. When your neurons are glycosylated, your nervous system gets affected, meaning your autonomous nervous system will get affected, meaning your sympathetic and your parasympathetic nervous system will get affected. Okay, therefore, you will start losing sensations in your hand and feet. You will have pin-pricking sensations as well, okay, at times. But basically, no sensation, meaning high risk of cut, wounds, which could be ulcerated, and this can turn into sepsis, gangrene, amputation. Okay, so yes, and guys, because you have glycosylation of the nerve impulses, even your heartbeat may be affected, and this can result in silent myocardial infarction, MI. Okay, because your cardiac nerve impulses is impaired. All right. So yes, you may not feel the pain in the heart attack, and these individuals may die of silent myocardial infarction, which is because of secondary condition, that is glycosylation of their neurons. All right. And guys, glycosylation of your GI system, okay, the neurons which is surrounding your gut, as I said, there is a neuronal system which is surrounding your GI tract, which I'll talk in the GI lecture. When that gets glycosylated, that is when you have conditions such as gastroparesis. All right. So now when you have glycosylation of the nerve endings of your reproductive organs, that is when you have all these sexual dysfunctioning happening, such as impotence. All right. Oh, so yes, I covered it over here. So yes, gastroparesis happens because you have glycosylations of the nerve endings of surrounding your GI tract. Therefore, you have that delayed GI emptying, which I explained over there. And thus the symptoms are nausea, vomiting, bloating, constipation, diarrhea, things like that, because the food is not being taken from the stomach into the intestine naturally. The peristaltic movement is lost. Okay, the food is just dumped in the stomach and it's just sitting over there. Therefore, you feel nauseated, vomiting, constipation, diarrhea, bloating, and all of that. Okay. And then the medical management is medical nutritional therapy. I talked about this in brief: small frequent meal, low fiber diet, low fat diet. All right. So all of that applies over here. Then you have medications like anti-nausea medication you may take, but these medications are more to address the symptoms rather than the root condition, the underlying condition. Okay, one of the things which is done is also enteral nutrition. What is enteral nutrition? We'll talk about that in your mental health lecture. We'll talk about that in your one of your lectures. Okay, and then finally, you even have surgical, management. So one of the surgical management is where you have electrodes which are inserted in your stomach. So they give a small little electric shock. So the stomach will start its peristaltic movement. But as I said, you know that electric shock is generally given naturally by your nerve impulses. So basically, as you know, what does your neuron do? It transmits neurotransmitters. What are neurotransmitters? These are chemical impulses. These are like small little electric waves which are going throughout your body, right? That's why you can move your hands, legs, and your body is functioning. So the small little electric waves that are naturally generated in us because of neurotransmitters, secondary to our nervous system, glycosylation will impair the neurotransmitter system, the nervous system. Therefore, now you have external electrodes, which will give you that small shock to stimulate the peristaltic movement of your stomach. Okay. So that is one of the management. Of course, this is not a medical lecture. So I'm not going into more of surgical management. Okay. So that's not something which we are covering. All right. So finally, the lecture is done. This has been a big, intense lecture. As I said, the first three lectures are one of the longest. No, the liver lecture is also pretty long. But yeah, but these are the three lectures: obesity, CVD, diabetes. They are the most extensively researched because these are the most epidemic conditions which you see around the globe. So yes, lot of research, meaning lot of concepts which we have to cover. Therefore, the lectures are longer. Okay, so I hope this has been useful for you. I'll see you in the tubes, and your CVD lecture will be recorded and provided to you online. All right, then see you in the next lecture. So let me just properly stop this recording. So I'll pause.